Hey guys, Trevor here from SpineWise, and today I want to talk to the people who have chronic pain. It might be neuropathy, it might be that you had this chronic sore back, it might be that you're just suffering from pain that just seems to be unrelenting. Maybe you've been spoken to about pain management and the use of different medications to try and nullify your pain to get you through life. Because it happens more commonly than we care to actually acknowledge. And a lot of people go through life losing belief that there is no hope for them and they're going to be ridden with medication. And that medication may not even be helping them in some way, shape or form at all as well. But maybe having a huge amount of side effects. So these are the people I want to be really talking to today. And ideally, you know, whenever you have chronic pain, make sure you keep searching for a solution because there are plenty of solutions out there. And sometimes the concept that you may just be a chronic pain person or a chronic pain patient may not actually be because you are, but might just be because people have run out of ideas with you as well. So never keep searching. But today I want to talk to you about those who truly have chronic pain, have gotten stuck into this issue. So these are really neuropathic patients or neuropathic people who really have these chronic issues. I want to talk a little bit about how it works, and I want to give you some insights towards the end of exactly some things you might be able to try that may potentially be able to help you, okay? All right, so let me explain the concept of chronic pain to begin with, because it's not very well understood by many. And what basically happens, we have a sensory nerve that we can see here. So we have input coming from one area into the nerve itself, and the sensory nerve has its cell body halfway along it. So the information comes in, it gets sent up, so we come in, it gets sent up, enters the cell body, and then it starts signaling to these little cells that are on the outside of it called glial cells. And as these glial cells start getting sensitized from this chronic stimulation over and over and over, eventually these little gate channels open between those cells and the body itself. Now, the reason why this is so important to understand is because of what happens next. So when you start constantly stimulating a sensory nerve, it almost gets used to it and it starts doing it on its own, and this is what we're seeing here. So now what happens, normally we get information coming up, going in there, coming back down, and then going back out towards our spinal cord. If we solve this problem, so let's fix this problem, we have no more damage down this side, so there's no more signaling going into it, and there's still communication happening here, these glial cells will tend to then signal in towards the cell body itself, and then the cell body will actually keep that information going. So even though you've resolved the injury, so it might be, say, you've broke your foot and it's now healed, you may have had a limb amputated and it's still hurting. Like, it doesn't really matter what it is. For most people, it's something as simple as you've had a tooth extracted, or you've had some dental work, or you've had your TMJ jammed, or you've had a head injury of some sort, and that's triggered off a neuropathy around your face, and now all of a sudden the trigeminal nerve keeps firing into the trigeminal ganglia, as it's known. And now, even though this problem has been resolved, in other words, there's no more damage occurring to the tooth, there's no one poking it, there's no one prodding it, the stimulation has been so great that this keeps signaling itself. Then over time, with that constant signaling, the information goes into the spinal cord, gets sent up to your brain, and then eventually the brain starts adapting to it, so we start getting changes in certain areas of the brain as a result of all this. And this area here, because it's been hit so many times, it starts getting used to getting hit. And as it gets more and more used to getting hit, it kind of turns up the microphone a little bit. And it starts wondering, hey, is there something going on here that I'm missing? Turns the microphone up a bit, and now you start becoming sensitized to it. And quite often what happens with that is it's not just information coming from here that gets sensitized, but also information coming from up everywhere else as well. And this can lead people into just generalized chronic pain states where everything seems sensitive to touch. And it's a very, very common kind of pattern. And this is often what we see with people with fibromyalgia as well. A little bit different mechanism, but a very similar thing. But this is very similar or very common to what we see with people who have chronic migraine problems, chronic trigeminal neuropathy. These type of patterns are very, very common in this type of situation. So, if we understand this, now we understand how do we go about correcting it. So the first thing we need to do, of course, which is the obvious thing, is we need to remove the trauma off this area, okay? We need to normalize it so that there's no more irritation coming in. That's step one. And that step basically involves, in the case of trigeminal problems, so trigeminal neuralgia, trigeminal neuropathy, these type of things, the big ones we really need to look at are the TMJ, the neck, The vestibular system, so your balance centers, are another common one. The jaw, absolutely at the top of the list. Eyes and ears, so often these people are light and sound sensitive as well. So these are other big ones we need to look at with this as well. And then also our bite pattern, which is often forgotten. So irritation around the face itself is a really, really common problem that is often missed in these type of situations. So step one is we've got to remove the damage first. If the damage is still there, we're going to keep stimulating. We've got to remove the damage. Once we get to that, the next big thing then becomes, how do we wind this down and how do we wind this down? So the brain side of things is an overstimulation. It's a brain arousal problem now. So the main neurotransmitter that we use to calm that down is what we call GABA. And some of you may be on medications that are GABA paced, such as gabapentin or Lyrica. And these are things that are designed to try and push your GABA levels up to try and calm the brain itself down. So that's the mechanism. So it's acting in this kind of area in the upper parts of the brain. But if we take a step back and still look at our trigeminal complex, this area here is something that we want to try and wind down. So there's a few things that we know that seem at very, very, I'm going to say this is very early research stages, okay? This is not proven, but there's a few things that we know that seem to have an effect here and that I've observed in practice over the years as well, it seemed to have an effect. The first one is resveratrol. So resveratrol is a phytonutrient that's found in the skins of grapes, which is what gives red wine its fantastic properties. So it does have some effect at reducing glial cell activation. Works really, really well at winding that down. The next one is chicken bone broth. And the research being done on chicken bone broth is more aimed at migraine than anything else, but it's a very similar mechanism. So we can kind of extrapolate it out. So we're talking about enriched chicken bone broth. So not necessarily the stuff that you make at home yourself, but the powder stuff that you can use, which is very highly concentrated. Does seem to have an effect at winding this stuff down. It seems to work really well at working with migraines too. The other one I'm going to add in here, which is still really, really early days in the research, but we have seen some people have some good benefit with it, is a substance known as grape seed extract. And this comes from the work from Paul Durham, who's out in Missouri. His work on this has been absolutely incredible, especially in regards to migraine sufferers. There is some hesitation using grape seed extract. You need to be very careful with it though, because grape seed extract can knock around your probiotics within your gut. So we want to make sure that we're well down the track of having that stuff properly assessed before we start using something like grape seed extract, which can potentially have other side effects associated with it. The next one is cacao. Strangely enough, the oil from cocoa does seem to have a really good effect on some of these things. There's some mystery that's been surrounded whether cacao can actually trigger migraines and trigger trigeminal problems or not. The latest research is suggesting that it's not and that it can't do that, but it does suggest that it may actually help wind this mechanism down. So cacao nibs, just munching on cacao nibs, can have quite a good effect on winding this process down as well. So that's this area here. Let's keep moving further on into our actual central nervous system wind-up. So a few key things that work well. PEA is an amazing substance. It's become popular over the last few years and is now becoming more widely available. PEA is a great little fat that's used within the brain. It's a naturally occurring substance in the brain. Stimulates a substance known as anandamide, which is what's responsible for that runner's high feeling that you get. We used to talk about endorphins. We know endorphins come out from other forms of activity as well. And don't produce that high that runners get. It's now understood that that seems to be anandamide which does that. And PEA is one of the substances which does stimulate that that hormone in the system. So fantastic research on it relating it to reducing pain. There's some really, really good information that's coming out in regards to PEA. Next one is saffron and St. John's wort. The main reason we talk about saffron and St. John's wort is that it's understood that people who have problems with their 5-HTP receptors, which in short is basically about serotonin, serotonin has an inhibitory effect at the spinal cord level, so at this level for pain. So when we start having problems with 5-HTP, and we have problems with serotonin production, this can potentially affect the way that the brain actually interprets and the spinal cord interprets the signals from the body in regards to pain. So we lose that dampening effect. So increasing serotonin may potentially have some benefit to those with chronic pain patterns. The two best ones around for doing that are natural. One is saffron, the other is St. John's wort. They're the two best that I've seen work. We need to be careful with both of them. We need to be careful with medications he's taken and all this stuff. You want to be properly assessed before you start playing around with them in any way, shape, or form. The other thing about serotonin with these things is that serotonin is also useful for frontal lobe function. And our frontal lobes are, to a great extent, help control our emotional state. And the lower our emotional levels are, the better our filtration of pain is and the less we perceive it consciously. So it's really, really important in helping out with that as well. And we know that there's a good correlation between temporomandibular problems, trigeminal problems, and mental health as well, which we can quite well, anyone who's been in, had a trigeminal problem in any way, shape, or form, whether it be neuropathy, neuralgia, TMJ issues, migraine, will quite well understand why that is. Next one is magnolia. Magnolia is a cool little herb, so it does a hell of a lot of different wonderful things for us. But one of the most important things that we see magnolia do is that magnolia is a GABA agonist. In similar ways that we have gabapentin and Lyrica, things like this, magnolia also drives GABA, which basically will have a calming effect on the brain itself. A few other things that can have an effect in that area as well, things like zinc, magnesium pyridoxal 5-phosphate, which is the active form of vitamin B6, can all have functions in driving GABA as well. So a really important one here with magnolia. I've also seen some fantastic effects from using magnolia with vestibular problems as well. I won't go into why that is right now, but there's something else that seems to work given its involvement up here. The final one I want to talk to you today about is andrographis. So andrographis is a cool little herb. It's primarily known as an antiviral herb, but andrographis has some phenomenal effects that is not really discussed about much at all. So one of the key things it does is it changes mRNA patterns for inflammation in the upper part of the brainstem. There's not a lot of research on it. It's early days in those kind of research, but the research that has done did show that that was the effect. And one of the big things is the area that we're talking about that is reducing that inflammatory response is exactly where the trigeminal nerve comes into. So into that whole midbrain mesencephalic area that is so important for sympathetic outflow, fight or flight responses. So anyway, guys, there's a few little key things you can look at to start with if you're suffering with chronic pain patterns, central sensitization, or neuropathies of sort. Again, don't go down a path of going down this track without actually getting properly checked, looking for medication interactions, things like that. A lot of people on chronic pain issues are on medications and they can be interactions with herbals. So you want to make sure that stuff is properly checked out. If you don't know where to start and you don't know who to talk to, you don't know what's what, just send me a message. I'm always happy to help you guys out in any way, shape or form you can. Likewise, if you've had issues for a long period of time with chronic pain, with neuropathies or things like that, and you're kind of stuck and you don't know where to go, just message me. I'm always happy to help you guys out. Or I'll comment down below and I'll get in touch with you to make sure that you're okay. Other than that, guys, I hope you've enjoyed the video. I hope you got something out of it. This is a quick insight into this as well. I'll put up a link for you for a booklet. I produced a booklet a little while ago, which goes through a lot of these herbs and substances and how they're beneficial, especially in migraine. So I'll put up a link below for you for that. So feel free to jump on, grab the book, it's completely free. You can take it with you. And it gives you a lot more in-depth discussion about each of these type of things and how they work and what they do and other things you can do, including the mechanisms that are involved in migraine type processes. Anyway, guys, if you loved the video, like it, please share it along. It's the easiest way we can help people out is by getting the information out to everybody. But other than that, unless you have any other questions, I shall catch you in the next vid. Bye for now. See you guys.